Today we're going to cover section 3 of chapter 5. Section 3 talks about switches, how switches work. So as we have discussed before, the switch, the way it works is that it receives a frame and then it uses some kind of a MAC table. This MAC table has the MAC addresses of all the nodes on the LAN, and where this MAC address is connected. So the switch itself has multiple ports, okay? So each port connected to a device. So this MAC table stores the port number, so this is port number 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on, and the MAC address of the PC that's connected to this port, okay? So when I receive any frame, what I need to do is that I need to check the destination address in this MAC table. If this destination address exists in the MAC table, then I know the port, and then I forward this frame to this port. If this MAC address does not exist in the table, what do I do?
Send
to all ports. Send to all connected ports except the one that the frame came from. So except this one. Okay? So send to all other ports, which means that technically the switch will downgrade itself to a hub because it does not have any information. So the MAC table does not have this destination address, so it will send to all ports. But when I receive this frame, there is a small piece of information that I learned now, which is what? In this frame, there is a source MAC address, right? So I know that this source MAC address came from this port, say port 10, right? So when I know that this MAC address came from port 10, I know that now PC with this MAC address is connected on port 10. If this entry is not in the MAC table, then I can insert it. So learning process is accumulative. So when I receive a frame, first, if the source MAC address does not exist in the MAC table, I store the fact that this MAC address exists on this port. And then I ask myself, does the destination address exist in the MAC table? If the answer is no, then I do flooding and I broadcast to all connected ports except the port that this frame came from. Okay? So that's...
So is this why you have to make a ping port?
No. Ping is network address, higher layer issue. We'll talk about that. So that's one issue. So there are two types of switches. There is the store and forward, and there is the cut through. Okay? So there are two, I shouldn't say two types of switches, two modes for the switch, two modes of operation. Okay? Because there is a feature in the recent switches, which is called MDAX. You can switch from one mode to another. The same switch can switch from one mode to another. So there is the mode of store and forward. So store and forward. And there is a cut through. Store and forward, what it does is that when the switch receives a frame, the switch has a buffer. It will store the entire frame into this entire frame. It waits until it receives the entire frame into the buffer. And then it processes this frame. It does two things. First, actually three things. First, it checks the source address. If the source address is not in the MAC table, it puts it in the MAC table. That's one. Two, it checks if the destination address exists. If the destination address exists in the MAC table, then I forward only on this port. If the destination address does not exist, then I forward on all ports. That's two. But before I actually forward, I have to check whether the frame is an error or not. And just the fact that I received the entire frame, it allows me to look at the frame check sequence. Because it's in the very last part of the frame, right? I check the frame check sequence. If the frame check sequence tells me that this frame is correct, there's no error with it, then and only then I forward it. Whether on one port or on all ports. Okay? It's very important. That's why it's called a store and then forward. First, you store the entire frame, and then you forward. So the good thing about this is that you don't send any frame unless you make sure that it's correct. But what is the problem with this? Speed. Okay? So each frame has to be stored entirely before you can think about forwarding or not forwarding. So just storing this will take time. So cut through tries to fix that speed issue by saying, okay, I don't have to store the entire frame. What I need is actually the destination address. So what cut through does is that when it receives the frame, it doesn't actually store it in the buffer. It only reads instantaneously only the destination address part. Only. Okay? Only the destination address part, as we have explained before. Okay? And then it forwards the frame right away. The good thing about this is speed. I don't have to wait until I store the entire frame. Right? So definitely the cut-through is faster compared to store and forward. However, the problem with that is that you may actually forward many frames and there is some error with it, or maybe the frame is not complete. Okay? So the only way that you make sure that the frame is correct and everything is correct is by the fact that you have to store the entire frame, check if there is any error, and then, which is what happens in store and forward. So there is a trade-off now. Those are two extremes. One stores the entire frame, okay, and cut through does not store anything. It just checks the destination address and then forwards, okay? The problem with, the problem with cut through is that you may actually forward many frames in error. And speed is not always good, right? Speed is not always good. Why? Because remember that if you send things very fast, the frames may collide. And as we said before, if you send on a shared medium and there's collision, what do? Both frames are gone and you have to retransmit them. It's like you are going to a roundabout and you don't check anything. You just follow through. So what is the problem here? Well, speed is good. No, it's not always good, because you may actually collide, okay? So the cut-through, there are actually two sub-modes in cut-through. There is the fast-forwarding cut-through, which only checks the destination address, okay? So the problem with this is that it causes high probability of collision, because I only check the destination address and then I forward. So there is a possibility of higher possibility of collision. Okay? Type. Cut through has another sub mode. They call it fragment free. The fragment free tries to address the trade off between extreme checking on the frame to make sure that it's correct and everything is correct versus extreme speed. Because storing the entire frame is one extreme, and storing nothing but the destination address is another extreme, right? So the fragment-free mode, which is part of cut-through, so cut-through has two sub-modes. One is fast-forwarding, and the other one is fragment-free. Okay? The fragment-free stores the first 64 bytes only. Okay? Stores the first 64 bytes. Why 64? If you remember, when we have discussed the frame structure, we said that the minimum size of the frame is 46 plus the header size, so it would be 64. Why is this the minimum? Because if there is any possibility for collision, the collision will happen in the first 64 bytes. Which means that when you send the first 64 bytes of the frame, chances are the frame will fill the entire cable. So all the nodes will listen to the fact that you are sending, and they will abstain from transmission. Yani, if you, there is a node that sends on the line. So when you send a frame, the frame itself is very long. Only the first 64 bytes, they will fill the entire frame in terms of analog signal, okay? So the first 64 bytes will fill the entire cable, giving enough chance for everyone to listen to the fact that I'm transmitting, okay? So therefore, if there is any possibility for collision, and they have done this experimentally, they have found that if there is any possibility for collision, chances are it happens at the very first 64 bytes. So that's why they said this is the minimum frame length. You cannot have any frame less than this to give enough chance to everyone to listen to the fact that you are transmitting. Otherwise, if the frame is too small, this will not give the chance to everyone to listen to it. And if others do not listen to it, they will send, right? If they will send, then collision will happen. So the probability of collision will be higher, okay? So the fragment-free mode tries to address the compromise of speed by storing the first 64 bytes of the frame. Only the first 64 bytes. The only problem with this, well, this will address the trade-off for speed, which is good. However, remember that the frame check sequences is at the very end of the frame. So fragment-free will not have the chance to check the correctness of the frame. So the only mode that makes sure that everything is correct and it avoids the collision is a store and forward, because it stores the entire frame, including the frame check sequence. Then it will have the chance to check the frame check sequence and make sure that the frame is correct.
Why couldn't they just put the frame check sequence at the beginning?
That's what we were. They put the frame check sequence at the beginning. That's a good question. There should be a reason for this, and actually, it's the only header. It's the only layer that has header and trailer, and the trailer has the frame check sequence. I'm sure there is a technical reason for this, and I think could be that there is no point of checking the correctness of the frame until you receive it all. You see what I mean? So if you put it in the beginning. If you put it in the beginning, you have to receive it all anyway in order to check the error. So I think that's the reason. Okay?
But why do you need to check to receive it all? I mean, for this case, we could just receive the destination and the frame check sequence, check for errors, and that's...
You have to check the correctness of the entire frame. You don't check the correctness of the header only. If you want to check the correctness of the frame, you have to wait until you receive the header and the data, and then you start checking the correctness of the frame, right? Using the frame check sequence. You see what I mean? So that's why you have to receive everything, and then use the frame check sequence to check the correctness. If you don't want to check the correctness, you don't have to wait until you finish. So that's why they put the frame check sequence at the end, not at the beginning. Because if it's at the beginning, you will read it, okay? But you won't be able to check anything until you receive the entire frame anyway. Okay, so that's when it comes to the operational modes. So we talked about store and forward, cut through, and cut through has two things, fast forwarding and fragment free. Another issue is, which is also explained in the video, which is the fabric structure of the switch. The fabric structure of the switch, the structure, the architecture of the switch from inside as a hardware. There are two types of switches in that case. And this is not a mode. This is like two different architectures for the switch from inside. It's two separate hardware. So we have the port-based switch and shared memory. And I think this is explained using graphics and everything in the video, which I thought is clear. So the port-based switch, it uses the concept of queues. So the switch, each port has a queue, And as we have learned in computer architecture, queue is first in, first out. So when you store the frames, it gets into the queue. And then it gets out only in its turn. Okay? Which makes sense. If you come first, you go first. It makes sense from the logical point of view. However, let's see the problem with this when it comes to switch architecture. The switch has output ports, right? So what happens if you come into the bank, you have multiple lines, you wait in one line, right? And then you get out. So assuming that we have a frame here, okay? And this frame needs to go to this output port. Okay? So this frame is now going into this output port, and it takes time to finish the transmission, right? This frame wants to go to the same port. What does it do? This port is now busy. So it has to wait. Okay? So this problem is called a... head of line blocking. Head of line blocking. This is what happens in the bank. You are going into the bank, and then you wait in one line. The problem is that based on your service, based on the service that you want, you may actually need the teller or customer service or something like this. So it's a problem that you have the lines for all types of services. So if someone in the head of the line wants to go to the teller, he would block all the other people behind him, even if they want different service. Okay? This one will have to wait for this port to be cleared, right? There are some other frames here which are waiting to go to a different port. They are waiting to go to a different port. They need different service, but they are blocked. They cannot go. Even though their port is empty, but they cannot. And this is the head of line blocking. They want different service, but they cannot take it because someone else in the front of the line is actually blocking the entire queue. This is the problem with queue. The other type is what we call a shared memory. By shared memory, we don't have any queues. So input ports and output ports are all connected through RAM. And we all know RAM. RAM stands for a random access. So there's no queue. Everything goes to the RAM, and you can access it in a random fashion. So you can take someone who actually came late first, right? Randomly. So I can access any location in the memory at any point in time that I need. I can access two locations at the same time. I have complete flexibility. The RAM will allow me to do this. The only problem with this is cost. Queues are always cheaper to build in terms of hardware versus RAMs are more expensive. Okay? So that's the shared memory switches are usually more expensive than the port-based switches in terms of architecture.
So for the queues, if they are not made of something like RAM, then what are they made of? Physically.
Here buffers, but the problem is that registers, and these registers are sequential. They are connected in like a chain. So when you store something, you store it at the beginning of the line.
So using registers is cheaper than
RAM? لا مش registers, storage units. They can be registers, storage units. But the thing about the RAM is that you can access two locations simultaneously at the same time. So this complicates...
About the cost.
Okay. The cost increases when your architecture itself allows you to access two locations at the same time. It's more complicated. We're not in a computer architecture course, but logically, if you have a hardware architecture which allows you to access two locations in the storage at the same time, this will complicate the architecture for sure. This requires some details, okay? So these are the differences. Okay. All right. As we said, so we talked about the modes of operation, store and forward versus cut through, and we talked about the switch architectures, and we talked about how the switch really works. There's only one issue at the end of this section, which talks about layer 3 switches. Briefly, what we need to know about layer 3 switches, layer 3 switches, they use both the MAC address and the logical address, or the IP address, to switch over the LANs. As we said, when we get to a network, to a local area network, what we use is the MAC address to transmit, right? And then to move from one network to another, we use the logical address. The problem with layer 2 switches is I usually know the IP address of the computer I'm trying to communicate to, but I may not have the physical address. If I don't have the physical address, then I consult ARP, the address resolution protocol, in order to get the physical address. Layer 3 may not need that. If the MAC address does not exist, it uses the logical address to switch over the LANs, which makes these types of switches more intelligent, but they are also more complicated. Because now you don't only have MAC table. You have a MAC table and you have another table to store the IPs, which makes it more complicated. The table that's used for storing IPs, they call it forward information base, or FIB, which is explained in the video. Okay? So what we need to know about layer 3 switches is that they use both MAC address and the IP address for switching. If the MAC address is there, it uses MAC address and IP. If the MAC address is not there, it uses IP for switching. Okay? So it knows which IP is connected on which port, which is another layer of intelligence. So the first activity here talks about how the switch really works in the base operation of the switch. And as we said, the switch consults this MAC table for transmission. If the address is there, then it forwards to one specific port. If the address is not there, then it forwards on all connected ports. So we need to know which ports we will send on, given this particular example. So this node wants to send a frame with this destination address and source address. Okay? So the question is, which ports do I send on? And what actions I will take? There may be more than one action. And we'll see that sometimes more than one of these apply. Okay? So we need to do this. Okay. So as we said, the switch does three things. First, it checks the source address to see, because it knows that source address came from port A, FA9. Okay? This is a piece of information that I may benefit from in the future. So I might as well use it. So do I have the fact that the MAC address 0E is actually connected to port FA9?
Yes.
Let's see in the in this MAC table. This is FA9. Do I have the fact that 0E is stored?
Yes.
Yes. I don't have this MAC address stored in the MAC table. When the switch receives the frame, it will know. I don't have to wait until I send. No, when I receive it in the buffer, I will know that at this port, F09, I have a MAC address called 0E. And here there are two locations because I have two MAC addresses connected on this port. And there may be multiple because this is a hub. The hub allows multiple connections or multiple nodes to be connected as if they are one, as we said before, as if they are one collected node. So this is one thing. So I will store the source address in the MAC table. Second, what is the destination address? The destination address is 0F. Do I have 0F in the MAC table?
No.
What do? I forward the frame on all the connected ports except the one that this frame came from, which is, in that case, port F09. So I have FA1 connected, yes, so I forward on FA1. FA2 is not connected.
Yes.
FA3 is connected, right? Well, I forward on FA3. And FA5 and FA7. FA9 is the one that this frame came from. So it doesn't make any sense to send on this frame.
بس في هب.
إيه؟
وصل بهب يعني. يمكن في devices غير.
This is a good point. This is a good point. In that case, I will not forward on this port, because this is the port that the frame came from. Okay. So if the destination is 0F, it will arrive to 0F anyway. If the destination is this, it will arrive to this anyway. How? Because the hub will broadcast anyway, right? So the hub will broadcast, so the frame will arrive. There's no problem. Yes, احنا هنا. This is how the switch works. احنا هنا we are discussing how the switch works. ما نسموش broadcast عشان ما نحصلش confusion هنا. فنقول ايه flooding. Flooding معناها ان انت you send on all ports except the one that this frame came from. ده تعريف الflooding. Okay. Broadcast معناها ايه؟ The destination address is all S. It's different. Okay. عشان بس نفرق بين الاثنين.
هيبعت يعني مش زيرو اف هيبعت لكل البورتس
except FA9 which is actually 0F is connected on بس هو اصلا 0F picked it up anyway because this is a hub.
فكده كده
هو وصل يعني بس
لكن لو مش هب.
When do I store the fact that 0F is connected on this port? When this node sends anything. When this node sends anything, it will arrive to the switch, and the switch will say, do I have the source address in the MAC table? No, so I store it. Okay? When do I store the fact that 0F is connected on port FA9? When this 0F tries to send anything. When it sends anything, the frame will get to the switch, and the switch will know that 0F is connected on port FA9. Then it will store this here. Here, in this location. Okay?
So the hub doesn't have a MAC address?
No, the hub does not deal with MAC addresses. It does not store anything. It's actually faster than even the fast forwarding. It's not, it does not read anything. It deals with analog signals.
Analog
signals. It's a physical layer device. It receives an analog signal, and then it amplifies this analog signal and send it on everything.
And the switch is capable of storing multiple.
Yes, of course, because the switch, yes, because the switch has a buffer, so it stores multiple frames in this buffer, and then it checks back the destination and it does all these procedures that we talked about.
And it's not all related for 1 hour to share.
لا, it's not related to fast forwarding or kaza or kaza.
I'm talking about the amount of MAC address can store for one port.
The MAC address that are stored in one port? That depends on the speed. It depends on the speed that the hardware allows you to use. So there is a limitation, and that's why there is some of the ports, there will be 10 megabits per second, or 100 megabits per second, or 1 gigabits per second. Okay, so there is a mode in the switch called auto MDEX. Auto MDEX is automatically, you may actually change the speed or the configuration of any port flexibly. So you can decide which mode you use, what speed to use on each port. But again, there is a limitation on the maximum speed. So if this switch has a maximum speed of, let's say, 1 gigabits per second, this will limit how many frames you can store in the buffer and process in 1 second. Okay? This is the limitation. In terms of actions, let's see. Switch adds the source MAC address to the MAC table. We did that, right? We added the 0E in the MAC table here. Okay, so this applies. Frame is a broadcast frame. That's why I told Hassan now. there's a difference between broadcast and flooding. Distinguish between the two. Frame is a broadcast frame which will be forwarded to all ports. This is wrong. Broadcast frame is what? Is when the destination address is all Fs. It's all Fs. Okay? This is not the case. Here we have a physical address, but the problem is this: the switch does not know about this physical address, so that's why it will flood. It will flood the frame to multiple ports, to all the ports that is connected. Okay? But the frame itself is not a forward, it's not a broadcast frame. Broadcast frame will have here all Fs, and that's not the case. Type. Frame is a unicast frame and will be sent to a specific port. The first part is right. The first part is right. It's a unicast frame, which means that the destination address is not all Fs, right? But it will be sent to a specific port. That's the wrong part. It will be sent, it will be flooded to all connected ports. Okay? So this one does not apply. It will be flooded. But here, this one, that the one that applies. So frame is a unicast frame, صح, and will be flooded to all ports. That's the correct one.
Shouldn't they say accept the sender port? They should, yes.
Just for completeness, they should. But say what? As I said, the definition of flooding, the definition of the word flooding, means that you send on all connected ports except the one that it came from. This is the definition of flood.
The delta frame
is a unicast frame. Unicast frame معناها the destination address is not all Fs. And this is correct. صح. مظبوط. But the problem is the second part. And it will be sent to a specific port only. Is this what the switch did? The switch did not send it to a specific port. Here, this question discusses this problem from the perspective of the switch. What the switch will do. Because this activity talks about how the switch really works. We have to confine ourselves. Now we are inside the switch and we're trying to see what do we do. Okay? Because externally, some other things are happening. PCX is sending to PCY, the hub will broadcast and do this and that. We want to confine ourselves inside the switch. Okay? All right, Kira? So, next. The last one does not apply. But this talks about the switch mode. So very quickly, we need to go this. I'll give you 1 minute only. So which mode of operation for the switch that buffers frames until the full frame has been received? This is store and forward. This is easy. Checks the frame for errors before releasing. Store and forward. What? No error checking. It does no error checking. So this is cut through. What? رابعة, it's a great method to use to conserve bandwidth on your network.
Cut through.
Both of them apply. I'll tell you why. Unless there is a missing part here in the question. If I say it, then I can specify one over the other. Okay? Conserve bandwidth معناه إيه? The bandwidth is the theoretical amount of data that you can send, right? Conserve معناه إيه? Conserve معناها increases the throughput. The actual successful transmitted bits. Right? This is what it means, conserve bandwidth. So someone might say, actually the cut through is very fast. So in that case, the throughput will be fast. But remember, as I said, speed is not always good. If you send very fast, you may collide, you may cause some errors. And errors has very high cost. Why? Because you have to retransmit these frames. If you retransmit these frames, this will lower the throughput. Okay? So there is a missing part here. اللي حيقول لي عليها دي one point.
Bonus.
ايه بقى اللي ناقص هنا? What's missing? If this question continues by
good but good
part
كلمه واحده ولا
لا 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 part full sentence هاي خلينا اختار one over the other
considering that there will be no errors
almost correct يعني صح given that the probability of error is low or high okay if I tell you if the probability of error is high then store and forward will be more efficient why because if there is an error if there is a higher probability of error when you transmit then it's better to check that everything is correct before you transmit and this will be the more efficient way if the probability of error is almost zero or very low okay probability of error here includes the probability of collision probability of error either due to loss or due to collision okay if the probability of error is zero huh then cut through will be faster and the speed will be good in that case okay but since this part is missing I cannot really distinguish one over the other okay so there is part of the question is missing here so again in the exam if I tell you given that the probability of error is high or low you should be able to tell which one is a the destination mesh the destination network interface card discards any incomplete frame so this is a يا راجل cut through and the faster switching method but may produce طبعا دي ايه cut through okay خلاص رقم 5 it's faster switching faster يعني ما cut through faster 5 it's discards any incomplete frame this happens when لان خد بالك store and forward will not forward anything that's incomplete because it stores the entire frame before it forward that's what it checks for error and everything before it forward right but the cut through is the one that a that discards any incomplete
but cut through doesn't even store the frame so how does it know this
انا بقول لك ده destination network not the switch the switch will not do this is the net card at the receiver side طيب this is the last one
2 minutes
yeah 2 minutes just 2 minutes yeah we still have time
straight through
so cabling used in this topology will be a
straight through
I'm assuming you have studied this in the lab. You have talked about straight through versus crossover and so on.
Yes.
Straight through is used to connect two different devices. Mm. Host with a switch, router with a switch, host with a router, things like that.
It's a type of wire.
Yes, it's a type of wire. Type. To find where PC is located, PC1 will send out a...
A broadcast.
برضو this is not complete. I didn't tell you whether PC1... will use ARP or the switch will flood يعني برضو هنا مش clear قوي يعني بس assuming that PC1 does not have any physical address or any knowledge about where PC2 is in which case it will trigger ARP صح اللي هو address resolution protocol by sending broadcast message اللي هو ARP request and then wait for PC1 to reply if PC1 sends ARP request as broadcast, then PC2 will respond as
unicast.
Tamam. If PC2 receives only half of the data in the frame, it will
discard.
أنا هنا again بتكلم على PC2, not a switch. فهنا it will discard. And طبعا الآخر واحدة اللي هي إيه؟
Store and forward. Yes.
If PC2 receives many damaged frames, it will switch. As I said, if many damaged frames معناها ايه معناها it figures out that the probability of error on the line is high so it switches to store and forward because store and forward is good when the probability of error is high then you better store and make sure that everything is correct خلاص